Welcome to worship this morning at First Baptist Church in Middlesboro, Kentucky. On this celebration weekend, we're glad to see you here. You're welcome. All of our home folks I see, and I welcome you, and any guests we have today, you are welcome. And if you would like to take the card from the pew in front of you and fill it out to tell us about yourself, you can put that in the offering plate when it comes around. You are all welcome this morning. Three things about First Baptist today. In the next couple of weeks, we'll have our monthly meetings. You'll see those on Happening Soon on the back of your bulletin. And we have a guest today that's very important. That's Michael Bayless. You've already heard him play. We're glad to have him today while Janet's taking some time away with her family. And also, if you will look on July the 14th will be the in-person office hours. If you need to see Elizabeth in person, it will be that morning. So if you want to mark that on your calendar, if you need to come in and do that. You're welcome today. Let's begin our worship singing hymn number 337, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. And we'll stand as we sing. Pray together. God, our Creator, all praise we bring to you today. You are above all and in all. We worship you because of who you are. We love you because you offered us love first. Be with us today as we've gathered. Hear our prayers, our songs, our sermon. Hear them as offerings. Teach us today. Open our hearts and minds to learn your ways more fully. and to take your love outside these walls as we are the church in our community and in our world. Give us courage to be Christ's hands and feet where it may be uncomfortable. Confront us when we can do better. Accept the gift of our worship today in the name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. If you'll take your bulletin, and we'll read together our confession. When we walk from darkness into the light, we can see ourselves as we really are. Come and confess your sins to God and wade into the river of the healer's mercy. God, you have caught us in our sinful behavior. We walk with our heads held high without noticing others and their burdens. We keep our mouths silenced when we are full of stories to share about the good things that you have done for us. Fill us with your peace and with your mercy. Peace. Peace is what you receive from God when you know that your sins are forgiven. Therefore, peace, my brothers and sisters. Thanks be to God. Our response is number 404, the first verse.
Our first reading is from the Psalms, Psalm 66. Shout praises to the glory of God's name. Make glorious his praise. Skip to verse 4. All the earth worships you, sings praises to your name. Come and see God's deeds. His works for human beings are awesome. He turned the sea into dry land so they could cross the river on foot. Right there we rejoiced in him. God rules with power forever, keeps a good eye on the nations. So don't let the rebellious exalt themselves. All you nations bless our God. Let the sound of his praise be heard. God preserved us among the living. He did not let our feet slip. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now let me lead us in our prayer. Gracious God, we know how blessed we are as a nation. You've given us founders who ended tyranny from kings, autocrats, and dictators. And we of all the nations on earth are very blessed. We thank you for our country, and as we celebrate our nation's birth, we ask that you help us to keep the gift we've been given. We thank you for all who've given us of their lives so that we may live in a free country. Make us ever mindful of the part we play in maintaining this nation. Be our guide as we vote and choose our leaders who will keep our country free, regardless of party affiliations. Surely we play a larger part in our country's democracy than we have ever realized. And likewise, we play a larger part in your kingdom than we've ever realized. The love we share, the forgiveness that we give, the care for the poor we practice, the service to others we offer, surely means more than we're aware of at any given time. Encourage us along our path. Help us to see the important part all of us play. We remember our pastor as he's away from us. Pray for his safekeeping. We pray for your blessings on our minister of music, all those who participate in that ministry. Pray for our deacons as they seek to lead us in service and in love. And we pray for each of us as members to see how very important we are in this church's ministry and how very much we are loved and treasured by you. Bless those who suffer in any way today. Surround them with your love and hear us together as we pray the prayer your Son has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our second lesson today is from the Gospel according to Luke. After these things, the Lord commissioned 72 others and sent them on ahead in pairs to every city and place he was about to go. He said to them, "The harvest is bigger than you can imagine, but there are few workers. Therefore, plead with the Lord of the harvest to send out workers for his harvest. Go. Be warned, though, that I am sending you out as lambs among wolves. Carry no wallet, no bag, and no sandals. Don't even greet anyone along the way. Whenever you enter a house, first say, 'May peace be on this house.' If anyone there shares God's peace, then your peace will rest upon that person. If not, your blessing will return to you. Remain in this house, eating and drinking whatever they set before you, for workers deserve their pay. Don't move from house to house. Whenever you enter a city and its people welcome you, eat what they set before you. Heal the sick who are there and say to them, 'God's kingdom has come upon you.' Whenever you enter a city and the people don't welcome you, go out into the streets and say, 'As a complaint against you, we brushed the dust off your city that is collected on our feet.' But know this, God's kingdom has come to you. I assure you that Sodom will be better off on judgment day than this city. How terrible it will be for you, Chorazin. How terrible it will be for you, Bethsaida. If the miracles done among you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they'd have changed their hearts and lived long ago. They would have sat around in funeral clothes and ashes. But Tyre and Sidon will be better off at judgment than you. And you, Capernaum, will you be honored by being raised up to heaven? No, you will be cast down to the place of the dead. Whoever listens to you listens to me. Whoever rejects you rejects me. Whoever rejects me rejects the one who sent me." The 72 returned joyously, saying, "Lord, even the demons submit themselves to us in your name." And Jesus replied, "I saw Satan fall from heaven like lightning. Look, I have given you authority to crush snakes and scorpions underfoot. I have given you authority over all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. Nevertheless, don't rejoice because the spirits submit to you. Rejoice instead that your names are written in heaven. At that very moment, Jesus overflowed with joy from the Holy Spirit and said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you've hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and shown them to the babies. Instead, Father, this brings you happiness. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our stewardship hymn today is number 482, Here I Am, Lord. Will you stand as we sing that together?
Thank you.
Let's pray a prayer of dedication for our offerings. For all of creation, we are grateful. For food and shelter, we give thanks. For family, friends, and a place to worship together, we are grateful. For our health and for our freedom, we give thanks. God, you give to us so abundantly. May we do the same in our gifts to you and to others. We dedicate these gifts today with expectation of the ways they can be used to show others your love. And with gratitude, we say amen.
Three straight weeks we've looked at Luke's gospel, and he has a way of knocking somebody's hat in the creek every single Sunday. It gets kind of tough. He's tough on those who wouldn't persevere. He's disciples. He's tough on people who won't welcome them. It just gets tough. And when you read a story like that, you have to look for what I call the hook. The poets, I'm told, call it a gate. I've always thought of it as a hook. You look for that part in a passage that carries the gospel. And that's the point. We're going to look at that hook today. Because all of us have times in our lives when we ask the question, do I make any difference? Do I make any difference at all to anybody, including God, especially God? Am I any good compared to others? Well, our lesson today, believe it or not, answers that question. Jesus sends out, most translations say 70 followers. Today's translation says 72. The point is, it was all of the countries known and believed to be a part of Luke's world in Jesus' day. So that Jesus is saying, I'm going to send you guys out on a mission of love, caring, mercy, showing people the God of love that I've come to show you. Now it's your turn. I'm going to send you into the whole world. That's the 70 countries. It is a big mission. That's the point. When they get back, Jesus listens, and then he says this about what they've done. I saw Satan fall. Now, in the original language, this is the continuing past tense. It's, I saw Satan falling again and again and again, wherever you went. It's metaphorical language for good over evil, love over hate. I saw it happening again and again. What you've done out there, you may not know it, but it makes a big difference. What you do matters. It really, really matters. Well, I think you and I need to read that. I think we need to hear that message to disciples, because when we ask that question and think sometimes we don't make much difference, I saw Satan fall. Is that enough difference for you? Every time you forgive someone, I saw Satan fall. Every time you help someone, you bless somebody with encouragement, with love, with a smile, with friendship, with help, I saw Satan fall. Good over evil, love over hate. When Mother Teresa visited an elderly poor man in Australia, she made his bed and cleaned his house and washed his clothes. And while she was doing all that, she found an old oil lamp. And she said, do you use this? Doesn't look like it's been lit in a long time. When's the last time you lit this? And the man said, well, I don't really have any need for it. I go to bed at dark. Nobody visits me at night. She said, well, would you light it if the sisters came to visit with you? He said, of course. After that, sisters came every evening to see how he was. 2 years went by, and she'd gone back to her country, and the sisters sent her this message from the old man in Australia. Tell my friend, Mother Teresa, the light she lit in my life continues to shine. And Jesus must have said, I saw Satan fall. Many years ago, they tore down the old First Baptist Church of Madisonville, Tennessee, my home church. Madisonville, Tennessee, you know where Madisonville, Kentucky is. Madisonville, Tennessee is 40 miles south of Knoxville. And the pastor called. I was just 17 miles down the road at the First Baptist Church of Etowah. He called and said, would you do our final sermon on Sunday night before we tear the building down the next Monday morning? That's when we're going to start the demolition. I said, well, yeah, I'd be honored to do that. Now, he had already had what he thought was a fitting final service that morning because, I mean, you know, that's back when they were having Sunday night church and nobody ever attended Sunday night church, even when we had Sunday night church. At any rate, the pastor always did. I was there talking to wood as it would bounce back. So I thought, well, he's going to ask me over there to talk to wood, but I'll do it because it's an honor just to be the last man preaches on in that church, even if it hits just wood and comes back to me. Well, we could have never expected what happened. People were standing in the back. The pews were filled. We had to bring chairs in for the aisles. The balcony, which is never used in the evening, it was full. That place was packed. And it was because they had come to say farewell to an old building, but not just any old building. They come to say farewell to a place where they had been blessed, they'd been inspired, they'd been baptized, they'd been married, they'd said goodbye to loved ones. It was a holy building, and it was an emotional night. You can imagine. It was like saying goodbye to an old friend. Imagine if they did that here. At the beginning of the service, the minister asked if anyone wishes to speak and tell of a meaningful experience that you've had in this building, please feel free to stand and do that. Well, people stood and they talked about former ministers that they had there that they loved. They talked about baptisms, youth programs, children's programs, Christmas programs. They talked about their parents and their grandparents that worshiped there with them, and they remembered it. Holy memories just came flooding back. And the more I listened to that, the more I was made aware. It matters. What we do really matters. Just listen. Just listen if you think it doesn't matter. Jesus says, I saw Satan fall. You get the point of that metaphorical language? It matters. When I served the church 17 miles down the road, First Baptist Etowah, I accepted the task of being in charge of caring for those who were in need. We didn't have a CCM there, you know. And so no of the other pastors, none of the other downtown pastors wanted to fool with it. And I said, well, I'll take it. And we collected offerings at communion time or once a month or even preferably some put it in their budgets to have money for those in need. And it was a bank account and they said, here's the checkbook, bye. If we see anybody that has trouble, we're sending them to you. I said, okay, I don't mind that. I've always had a concern in my heart for the poor. I'll take that. I've got that going for me anyway. I care that much for them. I remember on one occasion, a young woman had three small children, came to me in the dead of winter. She was not able to pay her utility bill, and they had turned her power off. That was not uncommon. We had had some warm weather that winter, and so the power went off. But that coming week, it was going to go way down, and she had no heat. So she was worried about her children. I called a man who was in charge of the United Way Fund in our county, because usually if it was a big bill, he would have it with me. He said, who are you helping? Well, I explained what the need was. And he said, I know that woman. I've helped that woman. I'm not going to help her anymore. She's not married. She got those three children, never has been married. She's a fallen woman. I can't help people like that. They're just no good. Thank you, Mr. Scrooge, and Merry Christmas. As it happened, I had to get my car serviced on that day. And as I sat in the waiting room waiting for my car to be serviced, the manager of that dealership was named Dick Fortney. The dealership was in Athens, Tennessee, nearby Etowah, 10 miles. I always went in Dick's office and sat and we talked and laughed. And what have you heard? What's the latest joke? We'd make each other laugh. On this day, I sat in the waiting room and I was writing and I was thinking, how am I going to raise this? I was trying to jot down names where I could ask for small donations. He said, what's the matter with you today? You look like you're disappointed, discouraged. I told him the story. I told him what the county way guy, the United Way guy of the county told me. He said, he told you that? I said, yeah. Well, he said, how much you need? I said, well, the bill's $600. And I said, I need half of it, and I'm trying to find donors. He clicked on his intercom, and the secretary answered. He said, bring me my checkbook. He wrote a check for $300. And down there where it says four, he wrote, those who have fallen. And I saw Satan fall. Let me tell you, I understand this metaphorical language Jesus is using because I've seen it in every church I've ever served. On another occasion, a hardworking young man who worked as a roofer, I don't know any job harder than that unless you're digging a ditch. He worked as a roofer. He never had any money. We helped him with groceries many times. He lived in a trailer in a poor part of town. He came to my office on December the 23rd. I said, James, what's happening, boy? What you need? He said, well, Jack, I'm embarrassed to come tell you this, but I don't have nothing to buy my kids for nothing for Christmas. And I said, well, let's see what we can do. I knew I couldn't take too much out of the fund for that, but I figured I could take it out of my wallet. So I started out the hallway to the door, and I met a man coming in. His name was Doug Tulloch, and he owned a grocery store chain called United Grocery Outlet. Had about 40-something stores in three states. I think there's one down in Tazewell. His wife played the organ. She was our organist. He said, where are you going? I said, I've got to go find some toys for this fella. He's got four little kids. And he said, really? Well, let me go with you. Let's give those kids a good Christmas. So he got in the car with me, and he bought toys and toys and toys. And the back seat was full and the trunk was full. And the whole, I thought, we're going to have to put them under our feet here in the front. Oh, he was just enjoying it. We brought those toys back. James came by, like I told him to, and he got those toys. I had them in big, big bags for him to carry. His eyes lit up because he knew his kids were going to have Christmas. He came back the day after Christmas and he had a friend with him that had visited it during Christmas. He pointed to me and he said, that's the man that made my kids have Christmas. And I said, let me take you to the man that made your kids have Christmas. I got him in the car and I took him over to Doug Tulloch's office and I introduced him to Doug. And Doug offered him a job working in his warehouse. My goodness, my goodness, how I saw Satan fall. You know, you and I may think that the little things we do in life, just routine acts of service, encouraging somebody, loving somebody that needs it, forgiving somebody that needs forgiveness, we may think we don't make that much difference. But if we think that, we're wrong. Keep on keeping on blessing others, encouraging others, helping others that are in need. Because just as it was in my home church that night, someday that person will tell others what you did. And someday that person will tell God what you did that you thought was nothing. George Dockery was for many years the pastor of the New York Avenue Presbyterian Church in Washington, D.C. And in one of his books, he talks about a visit he made when he was a very young pastor in Aberdeen, Scotland. He said there was a woman in the church that wanted her husband to meet him. He was young, her husband's age. If he sees you, he's going to like you, and maybe you'll come to church with me. So I want you to come to dinner. Well, George said, all right, I'll be there. They lived in a house out in the suburbs of Aberdeen. And out behind that house was a beautiful flower garden. Because her husband's name, his name was Sandy. That man worked in that flower garden all the time. He loved that flower garden. It was just his joy, his hobby. So they toured the thing. And he had to tell George what each one of those plants was and where it came from and all that. I know somebody else that does that. Well, they went inside for dinner. And they had a good time just talking, saying whatever you say when you're visiting. Then George got down to the real reason he was there. Hey, Sandy, I've really enjoyed meeting you tonight. I'm impressed with you. You know, who else would be impressed with you as the folks at our church? I think they'd love you and think you'd like them too. Why don't you come to church with us? We'd love to have you there. He said, no, George, I really don't need that right now. You know, I find God every day right here in my garden. I say prayers in that garden. I feel God's presence there. I sing hymns in there. Well, we all have sacred places like that. So Dockery understood, and he wasn't going to push him. He gave him his space, talked about how much he enjoyed meeting him. And then he went back home. Sometime later, Sandy's wife turned ill, and she stayed ill for about 6 months, and then she died. George had her funeral. A few months after the funeral, George thought, okay, I haven't seen him since I went over to see him after the funeral. I'm going to go back by and see how he's doing. He went back and they sat out back. That garden was just in no good shape now. It hadn't been attended to. Grief had rendered him unable to do that. And so it looked pretty bad. But George said, hey, Sandy, you love this place. You've not been doing much to it. No, I can't. I can't right now. He said, well, let me tell you about another garden where Jesus went through what you're going through, where he grieved and where he wept. It was called Gethsemane. Let me tell you that story. He understands what you're going through, Sandy. He's been there. And let me tell you about another garden where they buried Jesus. And he rose from the dead to give you hope. Your loved one is with God. Her life is not over. They talked. And as I read that, I couldn't help but put the book down and think, where would we be without a church that carries the message of hope and love and mercy? Because, you see, it matters. The fact that you're here today tells me it matters. You very well know how much it matters. What you do and the part you play matters. I saw Satan fall is just a way of saying you matter. You know, acts of kindness and love, they don't make the evening news very often. Nobody gets national awards for it. Compare it to the rich billionaires who can give millions of dollars. We might get the impression that we're not all that important, but Jesus disagrees. The next time you read this, I hope you'll remember what it means. I saw Satan fall. That's how much it means. And then he says, rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Now that's just how much it really means.
Let's sing a response to worship today. In your bulletin, we have a handout, If We Just Talk, of Thoughts and Prayers. That's our closing hymn. Will you stand as we sing that together?
Thank you.
What a wonderful attendance for a holiday weekend. All the wonderful guests who are members of the family, thank you for being here today. It really matters. Now, go with God, and may God bring you through darkness into light, through pain into peace, through death into life, and be with you wherever you go and with everyone you love. Amen.